southeast corner of a Midwest state is a little town that was touched by fate. It's a quiet town, and within its borders, they believe in natural law and order. So when the trouble came, they might not have survived, but for one brave man. And that is why, for as long as the winter turns into spring, there will always be someone in Fairfield who sings the Ballad of Big Ru. He was 6'6" and weighed 103 in his 17th year of CC. Plenty of lopsided rhythm from the 2 gallon thermos that he always had with him. He was always in program both morning and night. His sweatsuit and socks were all blindingly white. He'd get to himself, no one knew him by name, so folks gave him the handle that brought him to fame. They called him Big Ru. Big Ru lived the program. He felt most at home with his legs in full lotus on 3 slabs of foam. Folks said he looked silly, but most of them tried to sit somewhere near him and soak up his vibes. Because he gave off a glow that was almost a light that made even the foggiest programs go right. Big Ru loved his life and had no plans to change, but nature had something quite different arranged. One day when the program was about to begin, the dome doors blew open and a stranger walked in. His back rest and program clothes all were deep black, and his challenge was spelled out across his wide back in 6-inch red letters that glowed like a fire with 3 tough little words: Rakshasa for hire. Wasn't pretty as he looked slowly around, but it got a little wider as his gaze locked down on Big Ru. He wasted no time. He had work to do, so he smacked down his backrest across from Big Ru. He sat and he started by rattling keys. Then he cracked every joint in his hands and his knees. His breath smelled like something you'd find in a trunk. That whole row left her. They ran for the door. Except for one guy, the one he'd come for. Big Ru. Big Ru didn't seem to have noticed. As if listening to some angel sing. So the stranger cut loose with a wall-shaking sneeze that rattled the other folks in there like bees. A few more left then, and a lot more lost heart when the stranger let off a long series of artistically timed belts that seemed to resound and jolt every space. Said the silent one, surrounding Big Ru. Big Ru. Now the stranger was furious. He put his dues in to earn a big rep in the Rakshasa's humor. If he couldn't shake up that Big Ru school, he'd ship himself back to bad guy school. But he wasn't done yet. He made himself swear that Big Ru would remember that he had been. And that stranger leaned back, and he started to snore. He thought of a way to even the score with Big Ru. Now this snore was special, so seductive and soft that the 3 people left there began to nod off, and soon were asleep, but much worse than that. They were dreaming of chocolate and animal facts. He was still in there, heads with the worst he could send. Some even had nightmares of wearing blue denim. In horror they hung as the darkness descended, but even in dreams knew it all now depended on Big Ru. Stranger was sweating, and Big Ru had enough for her. Would he just sit there and let his friends suffer? Then it suddenly seemed that his point had been proved, because all in an instant he saw Big Ru move. Yes, one finger flicked out, something flew through the air, and the stranger was suddenly no longer there. Just a little brown helmet. Where his backrest had been, is what folks woke up to. That and the grin on Big Ru.
Big Ru. Big Ru.
Well, they crowded around him and they shouted with glee as he did sun salutes and drank father tea. They nibbled a rice cake as they begged him to tell how he managed to break through that rock-shining spell. But Big Ru just pointed and continued to nosh as they found that brown pellet of Amrit Kalash. And when they turned round to thank him, he was already gone. No, he never talked much, but he lives in this song, The Ballad of Big Ru. Bum 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 b